This is actually super interesting to me because it's one of the most famous proofs of all time. It's the proof for Fermat's last theorem, which Andrew Wiles famously solved. Now, I don't want to explain that. All I want to explain is what's at the heart of that proof. It's actually not what Wiles spent 7 years on. It's actually something else. It's the Taniyama-Shimura-Weil conjecture, which is now called modularity. So what we've got to say is Fermat's last theorem is true, and it has to be just as obvious as the fact that 1 doesn't equal 2. In this case, Fermat's last theorem reduces down to something called modularity. It's the modularity theorem. So it's not one doesn't equal 2 here, it's something else. So it's about two things. So it's about elliptic curves, and this is specifically for whole numbers and fractions, are actually modular forms in disguise. So what does that mean? And that's how I feel. Even as a mathematician, it's like, what? So what I want to do today is just trying to get you to appreciate what this means. Just an appreciation. Not the full thing, just an appreciation of what's going on. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to use much simpler equations. Right, what do you want to start with? So starting with modular forms. A modular form, now the way you need to think about this is it's something to do with symmetry. But there's different forms of symmetry, okay? And the one I want to show you today is called translational symmetry. And what it is this. Is imagine you have like an infinite plane. This is being nicely provided by brown paper. And imagine we actually have here, so I'm just gonna kind of like, just put like arrows to represent that I've chopped this up. Imagine now cutting this up into strips, infinite strips. But the important thing is that the strips are all the same width. And so now something has the symmetry, has the translational symmetry, because this goes on forever, like left and right. Okay, so you can imagine like this kind of situation. What has the symmetry, which you can basically take a strip of this and cut and paste, but what's important is we want to know what functions you can cut and paste. Yeah, a graph, but what it is, we're looking for an equation. We want something to generate it because say if you had like a picture, a funny picture in here, it might have a really complicated equation. Maybe it doesn't even have an equation at all. Like if you think about a pattern, I mean, this doesn't even have a regular pattern in my shirt. I usually like pretty regular pattern shirts. But the point is, I just want to show you something which actually has a very regular pattern. And it's something I'm hoping you've seen before. It's one of these things. But basically, this is a sine wave. So it goes up and down, up and down, up and down. Now this actually has a long, complicated equation. But the important thing is, it's like, even though it is this equation that you crank out, potentially you could cut and paste. So that's the idea there. A modular form has that, except it's hyperbolic geometry and it's really complicated. But if you get the, if you just appreciate the fact that it's a cut and paste thing, you take one section of it and you cut and paste, that's the idea. Now, not all functions are like that. How about a function like this? That's my attempt at a circle.
That's not bad.
Thanks, man. So a circle has an equation. I'm actually going to write the equation down just because it's fun. Basically, the circle, okay, is another equation, except it doesn't have translational symmetry. Think about it, it just exists in one section. So, what this relationship is saying, elliptic curves, so whole numbers and fractions, are modular forms in disguise. It's actually saying that you can fit a modular form into an elliptic curve. You can fit a translational symmetry equation into the equation of the circle. That's what it's saying. This is magical stuff. So how does this work? How can we make this work? Well, the way you have to think about it is that imagine now we had a point on the circle, all right? And now we start following it around, yeah? So, you know, let's just have fun. Maybe we could do it really quickly, go around really quickly, or maybe go slowly, maybe go fast, slow, fast, slow, fast, slow. But if we chose to do it at a constant rate, yeah, going round and around and around, imagine what that would look like if this was actually moving through space. So if you think about it, if I'm doing the circle, imagine now if I go like this. So now I'm going to start moving at the same rate as I'm going up. And so what's actually going on is I'm actually making a coil.
Like a slinky.
It's like a slinky, that's right. So now just imagine, right, what we're doing is we're actually creating a coil. Now again, if it was a slinky, you know how slinkies, you can like make them bunched up and... But imagine we've got a slinky that's just perfectly evenly spaced, yeah? Okay? So now that has an equation. That has an, it's like a helix equation. It's got an equation in 3D. But what happens if you look down the barrel of that helix? What would you see? Like if you looked straight down it and there was no perspective problems, like if you looked straight down the barrel, what would you see?
A circle.
That's right. So what's actually going on there is that the helix can fit inside the equation of the circle. And the only reason this works is because 3D space and 2D space are both flat. When you're dealing with curvy spaces, this is really not an option. And these are curvy spaces. The actual elliptic curves belongs to projective space, modular forms belongs to hyperbolic space, the complex numbers, I mean, they are really super curvy. But in this example, it's really nice because what we're doing is we're actually fitting three-dimensional numbers into two-dimensional numbers, not really three-dimensional. They exist in three dimensions. But you've got to think that there's a different relationship going on. So what the coil has translational symmetry. So this is the link between modular forms and elliptic curves. It says that this really strange function over here can fit inside this really dull function over here. And when this happened, no one believed it. No one believed you could stick, you know, you could stick this coil into the circle. The reason why no one believed it was because no one could visualize it so nicely like we can. Because as I said, they're completely different spaces. That's the connection that needed to happen to actually make Fermat's last theorem work. This is not the real thing. Because if you think about it, if you have a whole number or a fraction as it's cycling around, okay, as long as it's a fraction, there'll be a point where it will come back on top of itself. Like there's a point where fractions, because there's a number you can multiply a fraction by, you'll get a whole number. So what that means is in turning around a circle, if you start with some sort of fraction, you'll end up back at the same spot. But if you have an irrational number, which by definition is something that can't be a fraction, if you started at some point and went around by root 2, you'll never get back to the actual original position. So again, this is the feeling here of the proof, the fact that these numbers matter. So the type of number matters. This is not how the proof works. I'm trying to give you a feeling for what's going on. The fact that the reason why Fermat's last theorem involves numbers is because these numbers, the way the numbers are actually, they work together, impact whether you can put a curve into one of these. And so then how they linked it in here is the fact that they said Fermat's last theorem involves whole numbers. Therefore, the circle equation I'm making should permit one of these things, except they proved, all these wonderful people that you've seen on Numberphile, and you should be seeing if you haven't seen yet, all the wonderful people who actually proved this, they showed that that created a contradiction. So basically, even though you're playing by the rules and using whole numbers, not even fractions, whole numbers, it doesn't permit one of these things. So again, it's the one not equaling two.
Our thanks to audible.com for supporting this Numberphile video. They've got something like 180,000 spoken word titles in their collection, and I often enjoy listening to, well, just a few of them on my daily dog walks here with the girls. Now, if the beauty of mathematics is something you like, why don't you try Love and Math, The Hidden Heart of Reality? It's by Edward Frenkel, someone you've probably seen in quite a few Numberphile videos already. It's got all sorts of great stuff in it, including quite a lot about Fermat's last theorem. It's something that's not a million miles from Professor Frenkel's own research. And like so many books, it's available in audio form at Audible. So go to audible.com/numberphile if you'd like to give it a try. Or when you sign on for their free 1 month trial, you might choose a different book from their extensive collection. There are plenty of math ones, I can assure you of that. That address again, audible.com/numberphile, so they know you came from here. And as a very happy Audible user myself, I'd like to thank them for supporting this video.